Good morning. I just want to let you know that we'll get started in about 5 minutes. So if you you want to grab a extra croissant or bagel or a cup of coffee, this is your time to do that. And we'll get started shortly. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. I'd like to welcome everybody to Breathe LA's 8th annual COPD conference. My name is Steve Bryson, and I am the current chairman of the board of Breathe LA. In recognition of the significant health threat imposed by the widespread incidence of COPD, we have come together today to share innovations in COPD care and management. Breathe LA is grateful to have the support of our silver level sponsors, Chest Foundation and AstraZeneca, as well as our conference exhibitors, Boehringer Ingelheim, Respirtech, and Genentech, which will be available to you during our exhibitors hour this morning. Commitment to improving the COPD landscape in Los Angeles County is the goal of Breathe LA and my fellow board members. Your attendance today signifies your commitment to these same goals. This year's conference theme, Optimizing Outcomes, New Technologies, and the Management of COPD, presents a unique opportunity to join professionals committed to improving early COPD detection and COPD health outcomes for Los Angeles County residents. It gives me great pleasure to introduce to you a longstanding local leader in COPD and an 8-time chair of the Breathe LA COPD Conference. Dr. Guy Soo Hoo is the chief of the Pulmonary and Critical Care Section and director of the Medical Intensive Care Unit at the West Los Angeles VA Healthcare Center. He is a clinical professor of medicine at the UCLA Geffen School of Medicine and a longtime member of the Breathe LA Board of Directors, currently overseeing our program and research committee. He leads the Trudeau Society of Los Angeles County on behalf of Breathe LA and is truly committed to improving lung health of our local Los Angeles community. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Soo Hoo as the moderator of today's COPD conference, and thank you all for attending today's event. Dr. Soo Hoo.
Good morning. Thank you, Steve. I welcome all to all for attending this year's conference. This is our 8th conference, and I think many I've seen some familiar faces from the past. And you can all can vouch that we have expanded this and focused on areas that we think are pertinent to the community. And so I am from the West LA VA, and here is picture of that in Breathe LA. So I want to also take this time to recognize Cedars-Sinai Medical Center for being the host here, and also there is a packet in your handout that allows you to get continuing medical education, 3 units, Category 1 credit, and that's given at the end after you complete the summaries. Also appreciate our sponsors, and they've been identified as Chaux, AstraZeneca, Genentech, Boehringer Ingelheim, and Respirtech. And if you have an opportunity during the conference and break to visit their booths, much appreciated. I have no other conflicts to disclose. And I think what my task here is, one, to keep the conference going on schedule, and also to provide you a little introduction and background as to what we're dealing with. So COPD past, present, and future, I think, is part of a theme, and also we're going to look to identify some technologies that will improve outcomes. But I think that if we go back, you know, when I was a fellow, this is what COPD was like, and I think some of you, well, watch that. I know that some in the audience were attending staff when I was a fellow, and this is COPD. This was Mr. Pink Puffer, Mr. Blue Bloater. Let me just see. I don't know if I have I guess there's a pointer. Anyway, so I think that on the left and the right, and this was more or less what we thought about COPD. If you look at the ATS, the American Thoracic Society, their statement on the diagnosis and care of patients with COPD, well, what did they tell? This is a consensus statement, 1995, a little bit over 21 years ago. COPD, airflow obstruction, partially reversible. Well, that's probably true. But in summary, their conclusion was it's primarily irreversible. Once you got it, it's done. So what about CT scans? I just picked out bits and pieces, but CT tomography, CT scans have no place in the routine care of COPD. I'll provide you some information that may give you some additional information about why CT scans may be of use. And then the main medications, and those in the audience who deal with these patients realize that these medications are still present, mostly, but not widely used and certainly not first line, albuterol, ibuprofen, theophylline. You know, salmeterol was the newest drug on the market, and that's been many generations past. This was the concept of COPD. You know, the three Venn diagrams: chronic bronchitis, emphysema, asthma, and somewhere in the intersection was COPD. Well, I think that is a good working definition. That was fine 21 years ago, but a lot has happened in that time frame, and so. The GOG, the Global Strategy for Diagnosis, Management, and Prevention of COPD, National Worldwide Guidelines, just came up with their 2017 update. And so they did this literally a few days ago, and so I've taken from that. And I just want to highlight some things that are important and differences from what has been known or the concepts of the past. But one that it's common, but it's preventable and treatable. So remember in the ATS statement 21 years ago, was probably not, there was sort of a nihilistic approach to it. It wasn't really treatable. Persistent respiratory symptoms, airflow limitation, due to both airway and alveolar abnormalities. So a little different concept, caused by exposure to noxious particles and gases. So not just, you know, not just smoking. So symptoms, dyspnea, cough, sputum, but often underreported by patients. The main factor is tobacco, but there's other environmental exposures, biomass effusion, air pollution, something that were novel concepts back in 21 years ago. In addition, there's host factors, genetic abnormalities, and these things all contribute to the development of COPD. And so you have periods where there's exacerbations, worsening of respiratory symptoms, and there's a lot of comorbidities also involved. And so we're all COPD Day this year, worldwide. Day recognition was in the middle of November. We missed that, but GOB did provide some information. And one, so worldwide, 1 in 10 adults over 40 have COPD. That's an astounding number if you think about it, in the condition that is really related to what you inhale. 1 in 10, 10%. So 3 million people die each year from COPD. So it's 6% of all deaths. So that's a tremendous amount of mortality. And it's the third leading cause of death, surpassed only by cardiac abnormalities, heart attack and stroke, and has increasing rates. And it costs a ton of money, $31 billion and upwards. And so millions of days of loss of work. And another scale, this is from a Lancet article in 2004, about 12 years ago. You can see that COPD is the only one condition here that's increasing, 163% over a course of about 20 years here. But so that's in 1998, but there's additional data. This was published last year. And if you look on the upper right and the male and females on the bottom. Heart disease, you can see, is declining. If you look on the graph onto the right, and then the gold, COPD in the middle, is actually for males, is increased and sort of maybe plateauing, maybe decreasing. But for females, I think the striking thing here is that gold line that you see at the bottom right, it's increasing. So for women, COPD rates are for mortality is increasing. And it's maybe starting to plateau, but it's something probably people didn't recognize 20 years ago. And this is data up to just a few years ago. So how do you make this diagnosis? So you have conditions, yeah, and so I think that often people who present with this condition may not recognize or underreport their symptoms. I think now it's pretty clear. GOTA's identify that you should be able to screen for this. You have a COPD screener. It's validated. It's been used, developed by Fernando Martinez and colleagues. And you ask five simple questions. Have you feel short of breath? Have you cough up phlegm? Have you had any problems with your breathing? Smoked at least 100 cigarettes? And how old are you? You have 5 points, then it increases your likelihood for COPD. So when you have that likelihood score, then you have the symptoms, risk factors, tobacco being the most common, and then spirometry is recommended to establish a diagnosis. Still the same, although for 2017, GOAT has identified additional host factors that might be of concern. And so I don't need to belabor this much, but this is the post-spirometry criteria, FEV1, and a ratio less than 70%, graded mild, moderate, severe, very severe, and very severe, modified Medical Research Council dyspnea score, going from 0 to 1, and most of us, I hope, are at 0, but you know, every once in a while, you know, early dyspnea defined as 1, having a little difficulty going up a hill. But then many of our patients come to us, you know, at 2 and 3 or 4 levels where they really short of breath of really minimal exertion. And then the COPD assessment test, the CAT test, a test of eight variables, but things that you can mark to get an idea about their symptomatology. So things, I never cough, you know, 1 to 5 scale, Likert scale. One, I never cough, or I cough all the time. I have phlegm, no phlegm, chest tightness, walk up a hill, limited activities. Are you, you're confident getting out of the house? You sleep well, lots of energy. So 10 or more is defined as an increase, and so that helps in identifying patients who may be subject to different modalities of treatment. So 10 is the threshold here, and it goes to you can see here, it goes from 0 to 5, so 50 is the max. So what about that 70? So that 70% is sort of etched in many people's minds, but it does raise a potential that you have patients who are younger, who have ratios less than 70, who may be underdiagnosed. And I think that this is part of the issue I like to focus on. And so it's like an iceberg. So how large is this iceberg? Well, this is a pretty large iceberg. I got this off the internet. It's very large. And so what do we know now? Well, know now that we probably have about 15 million people with COPD in the in the U.S., 6 getting treatment. We have the that's the iceberg. So on the very tip, at the very top, about 2.5 million, very, very severe. This is most of the patients that we see on a regular basis. Probably about half of the patients are undiagnosed with COPD. So, but that's not the rest of the iceberg. The rest of the iceberg is people at risk. There's probably I didn't realize this, but half the adults over 45 in the U.S. are current or former smokers, a testament to the smoking cessation that's occurred over time. And 20% are still smokers. So we have a large group who still may have undiagnosed subclinical COPD. Is that an entity? Is that something that has been recognized? Not really, but I think it's become more of an issue because if you look at other surveys, so cross-sectional analysis from the NHANES study, looking at the GIST spirometry to identify patients with the ratio less than 70%, but they may not be diagnosed. And so they figure maybe 70% of these patients in NHANES are undiagnosed. What happens to them? Well, if you look at the curves here, the undiagnosed obstructive lung disease patients are a little better shape, but they follow the same trajectory as those with diagnosis. That's the middle and the lower line here. So they have the same outcomes in terms of time frame. If you look at COPD gene, another observational cohort study, 10,000 patients, they've looked at Caucasian and African American, and they've also done extensive work to identify us, but they've looked at their recently published last year about what they call COP0. Those are patients with normal ratios, and their FEV 1% is over 80%. So those are people you see in the office, you see anywhere, you'd say, you get spirometry, you don't have COPD based on GOAT criteria. But if you look at the graphs here, you can see that the CT scan showed that there's early emphysematous changes, that's panels A and B, and the airway is thickening in the C and D. And then so that if you look at the bottom left over time, there is an increase in the amount of emphysema that occurs in patients as they age. Actually, let me just, okay. And so these patients, half of them have some respiratory issues. They don't have good quality of life scores based on St. George's. They don't walk as well. They have CT evidence of emphysema. Their ratios are normal, but they're still lower than normal. And then maybe 35 million or more of these in the U.S. over 55. So undiagnosed patients. So another study, it's by Romix, another long-term study, observational. And they looked at the same level of patients. These are smokers with preserved lung function. KISS report came out in the New England Journal earlier this year. And half of them, if you look at the 10 score here, half of them on the CAT score have respiratory symptoms. They have more exacerbations. They don't walk as far. And so they all have some elements on CT imaging that suggest that they have damage from their smoking. And they use respiratory medicines more. And so this is the second and the third columns here will show you that these are patients who have normal function, and they all use more than these smokers. And the third column, the third will show that they all have comparable or more use of medications than those who have diagnosed COPD with mild. So I think that this is something that has been previously not well recognized, and something that will be part of the forefront of patients to focus on. And so this concept of COPD phenotypes, relatively recent, but certainly not well emphasized. But certainly we have patients that we've already sort of know about, the emphyseminous pink puffer, the emphyseminous patient, the chronic bronchitic. But also there's patients with just have bronchial hyperactivity, the asthma overlap syndrome, OSA, and COPD. And so these have changed the Venn diagram. So I think that airway limitation is what we define as COPD, encompasses all of these entities, and then probably more, because there is more that will occur as we go through time. And the GOAT has identified a different approach, very similar but not the same as previously, because there was some confusion. But certainly looking primarily at treatment based on exacerbations and symptoms, less so on the spirometry. So I think that's become a de-emphasis. And this is actually just came out a few weeks ago. All right, so I think that just to summarize, third leading cause of death, only cause with increasing rates. You know, I think that what's not recognized is that more women die from COPD than breast cancer and diabetes combined. And which disease gets the most press? Breast cancer, maybe not so diabetes, but there's a all of October is devoted to breast cancer. So half the people with COPD don't even know they have it, which is astounding. And plus, it's a treatable preventional condition. And this is the new gold logo, Breathing the Knowledge. It talks about tobacco cessation, because it's not just smoking, but early diagnosis, spirometry, symptom management, nutrition, action plans, all these of which we'll discuss this morning. And this is a busy slide, but I just want to highlight that the top, smoking cessation is the key. And then if you go throughout, there's issues with pulmonary rehab, oxygen, and all these things that we'll touch on this morning. And I want to alert you, we also have a COPD advisory council. We took the GO guidelines because they were, a little expansive, and sort of distilled it into guidelines that we hope are more useful for the provider, and it asks just the same things we discussed. Ask about COPD, get spirometry, coexisting conditions, treat to reduce symptoms and exercise capacity, smoke cessation, rehab, and other entities. So just to summarize, so this was the old concept of COPD, the pink puffer and the blue bloater. This is a slide that from a recent Drive for COPD, a recent campaign that was meant to highlight COPD. But I think if you look here, the faces are different. They're all recognizable, they're different. So diversity, Michael Strahan in there, women, Danica Patrick, I think that's Reba McIntyre. And this slide was made before Bruce Jenner became Caitlyn Jenner. So I think there's another community out there that also has investment in COPD. Okay, so this is our 8th conference. This is our agenda, and I think that we're right on time. We have a tight timeline, and I have my watch is 9:20, so I'm going to proceed with our next speaker. And so our next speaker is Cherrie Ng. She's a coordinator with the California Smokers Helpline. There is a booth here that highlight that. She's responsible for publicizing information, increasing awareness of the California Smokers Helpline and its services. She joined the helpline in 2005 and made many new partnerships with smoking cessation. As you could gather from the GO guidelines, the smoking cessation is the crucial element in preventing COPD. She's had provided training to many other services, including California Women's, the WIC, perinatal services, Planned Parenthood, and so that we're really over 10 years, decades of smoking cessation expertise. And I want you all to welcome Cherrie Ng to the podium.
Good morning, everyone, and thank you again for inviting me to this conference, and I'm very excited. Actually, we missed the COPD conference last year, and I'm so happy that we can join it this year. And just like Dr. Soo Hoo mentioned earlier, we have a table outside, so I am looking forward to meet all of you. So if you get a chance, stop by our table to get some information and also the new resources that we have for our for the healthcare providers just like you. So for today's presentations, it's very simple, but there are also some of the new strategies and things that I would like to share with you so that you can help your patients to cope with COPD more efficiently, especially to those who are the smokers and they can find the right resource to help them to quit smoking. Before I get started, just want to do a quick survey here. How many of you have heard of 1-800-NO-BUTS before? All right, okay. And how many of you have referred patients to the helpline before? Okay, thank you. And okay, this is the last questions that I want to ask you. And how many of you have used our online referral services? Okay, so this is one of the new service that we provide to the field. So maybe this is something that you are interested if you want to find out more. In my slides, there are some really good informations of that. And here are some of the objectives that we are trying to achieve. But of course, I'm sure you are all of the expertise about the COPD. I'm not going to talk too many of that. I'm just going to breeze through it and to focus more on about our services and what can you do to help your patients to quit smoking. As all of you know, cigarette smoking is really bad, and I have counseled some of the smokers, and even themselves, they know smoking is not good to them, and they want to quit smoking. It's just a lot of times they couldn't find the right way to do it, or they just feel that it's so hard to quit smoking. And according to the U.S. General, it's also telling us that this is one of the leading causes of preventable disease and death in the U.S. And in 2014, we are happy to see the number of smoking rate has been decreased from 20.9% to 16.8%. It's a good trend. Hopefully, we can do a better, and because we know that even though it is decreasing, but there are still 16.8% people, they are still smoking. And and we also know that smoking is one of the leading causes to help develop the COPD. And of course, besides smoking, there are some other issues or some other ways that can develop the COPD, like the air pollution or long-time exposure to the secondhand smoke. So it is also very important for us to help to advise our patients not to you know, get too close with the smokers or try to stay with the long-time exposure to the other irritants that may develop the COPD or make the situations worse. And quitting smoking is actually the most important step that can take to treat the COPD. And that's why your cessation advice is very important. A lot of times we do have our clients that called us and let us know that they called because they get the information from their health educators or healthcare providers, nurses, or when they go to do that physical checkup, they got our information and their doctor shares with them, here is the number, maybe this is something that you can call the counselors and to have the counselors help them. And the studies also tells us that smoker actually, if they advised by the healthcare provider, they are twice as likely as those who did not receive those advice. And they are more likely to make quit attempts. Quit attempt is very important. In later of my slides, there are some statistics that I would like to show you. And Because of that, every time when you see the patients, and if you can quickly give them some information like our go cards or brochures or something that you think your clients or patients that are interested to quit smoking, you can share it with them. To be honest, when you give them the first time, they may say, no, I'm not ready to quit smoking. I think I'm okay. I can do it by myself. But a lot of times when they receive those information, even though they don't do it right away, but the more time they see it, one day they may be able to think, maybe I should go to that section, maybe I should go to call this number to see what they can help me with it. And also, our services is a free service, California Smokers Helpline, also known as 1-800-NO-BEDS. And we started our service since 1992 at UCSD, and we are also funded by Proposition 99, Proposition 10. And because of that, we provide a service that is free of charge, and we also open our centers from Monday through Friday, and also we open on Saturdays to help those that may not be able to give us a call or they're just so busy on the weekdays. They can call us on Saturdays as well. If they call us after the service hours, they can always leave us a voicemail, and then we return the call within the next business days. And for now, besides the phone counseling, we also got some other online services that they can take advantage of, and I will share those later. And also, besides providing the services to the regular smokers, for those who are pregnant, or if they have other issues, they're not smoking, but they're using chewing tobaccos, or if they have a hard time to quit using the nicotine patches or the gum, they can also call us too, because we have those informations and we can share with them what are the other strategies that they can use to help them to quit using other things besides, I mean, quit using the nicotine patches or the nicotine gum. And for the people that they are under 18 years old, we have specialized materials for teenagers, because we know that they are early smokers. They started it due to different reasons, and we want to help them to see themselves, to make the decisions to quit smoking. And quitting smoking, it's something, it's a grown-up decision, because a lot of times they think smoking is really cool. They're trying to copy what other adults are doing. So we do have services for these different people too. And these slides, it's give you some idea about when the caller called us, what are the things gonna happen first. And some of the healthcare providers and health educators, they would have a question and they may ask, what if my patients, they are just really, they just don't want to quit smoking. They just tell me that I'm not going to smoke, I'm not going to quit smoking. Should I still refer these patients to us? The answer is yes. And from this diagram, it's going to tell you why it can change their thoughts. So for a client, when they call 1-800-NO-BEDS, they will go into an intake section. Usually that takes about 2 to 3 minutes. There are some basic questions that we will ask them. For example, their smoking history, how many cigarettes that they are smoking, and what are their health conditions, whether they are suffering from any breathing problems, heart disease, or have they been experienced stroke before. And then one of the intake questions that we will also ask, we'll be asking them, would you quit smoking within a month? And if they said yes, then the other questions that we will offer is whether they would like to have a counseling. If they said yes, of course, we will find an available counselor and provide counseling to them. And we will also send them these take control guide. Let me see if that works. Oops. Okay, so that is the book that's called The Take Control Guide. This is for the people that they are ready to quit smoking within a month, and they are pretty much want to find something that is practical, they can do, and to help themselves to quit smoking. And then, but for those who said no, we will still send them the Take Control Guide, and we encourage them to call us back after they read this book. And then for the people that if they answer no, they are not ready to quit within a month, and if they we will still offer them counseling. And if they said yes, then we will, of course, schedule them with a counselor and send them another book. And then for the other persons, if they said, no, I don't want counseling right now, then we will still send them the other booklet that is called the Design Guide. So the differences between the people they are ready to quit and not ready to quit, we give them the same service option, and they still have the options to say yes or no to whether they want to receive counseling or not. So if they said yes to receive counseling, even though they are not ready to quit within a month, a lot of times when they talk to the counselors, they may change their mind. They may feel that, you know, maybe I should give it a try, or they have some kind of good conversations, or they can get some good information, and they feel that, this is not so difficult, I should, you know, at least try something. And then for those people, even though they turn down our counseling service offer, they will still receive the design guide that helps them to think about how to become a smoke-free person and to prep them to make the quit attempt decision. So whether your patients, they are ready to quit smoking, I think it's always good to refer them to some kind of smoking cessation service and to give them a chance that they may be able to expose to the different ideas and they may change their thoughts while they are, you know, contact with the counselors or with the people that to help them to quit smoking. And we will provide a self-help materials to each of our callers, even though for callers, they are not smokers themselves, but they are the family members of our smokers, or they're just calling for their friends, they can still call us. We have the different booklets that provide to these people so that they can help their beloved ones to quit smoking. And we also know that some people, they may want some additional services. So talking to our counselors over the phone may not be enough. And we will have a local cessation programs on our website that we will refer our patients to look at it. And for example, in LA County, there is a list of different programs that are listed in LA County area. And if they are interested in going to any of those programs, they can call these programs and check on those. And besides getting the telephone counseling support, they can also go to these support groups to have some more additional help to help them to quit smoking. And on our websites, there are always new webinar, new training, and new slides, and some other good information that help smokers, healthcare providers, and other people that they are trying to help smokers to quit smoking, they can look into as well. And then for our counseling call, besides the intake call, if they said yes and they would like to receive the counseling, the first counseling call is the longest one. It's about 30 to 40 minutes. Here are the three main areas that we put a lot of time to help the clients to find out. First of the things is we want to help them to build their self-confidence. We want them to know that they can do it. It just takes some time and they just have to find the right way to do so. And because it's a one-on-one counseling, we can focus more on every individual, what do they want or what are their personality like, and help them to create an individualized plan to see what are their triggers and what are the difficult moments and to help them to cope with those problems. And towards the end of the first calls, we encourage them to set a quit date, because if we just share a lot of information, they just give us a lot of things about themselves and never put a quit date, that means that we're just talking it in words. So we encourage them to make a quit attempt. And then after the first phone calls, if they are decided to have a quit date, and we will provide up to four additional follow-up phone calls with the same counselors. Usually it takes about 5 to 10 minutes to follow up with the clients to see if they have any questions about quitting smoking, or do they have any questions if they're using the patches or if they're using other kind of nicotine replacement therapies. Sometimes they may feel that it's weird, or they just feel that, oh, I don't feel well, or they may have some other issues that may come up. We want to learn about what are they experiencing and to help them to overcome these. And a lot of times, they just need to talk to someone to help them to get it through. And during the first week of the quitting smoking usually is the toughest time, and a lot of the patients, they will go back to smoking easily. So our follow-up phone calls is not based on once in a week or twice in a month. We do it based on the relapse-sensitive schedules, which means during the first week, we schedule more calls, the quit day call, to see how they're doing. Are they started their quit date or they want to postpone it? And then 2 days after the quit date, and then 1 week call, and then 2 week call. And we want to make them feel that they can do it and we are there to help them. And so this is more detailed information about what we actually talk about during our first phone calls. And we will also talk about what are their health considerations and what are their quitting smoking history, because the more we learn about the smokers, we can give them more useful information that to help them become a smoke-free person. And then for the motivation, because we know if they just tell us in a very general idea saying that, I want to quit smoking because somebody's told me to do so. I'm not quite sure whether I can do it, but I guess it's good. We don't want them to have those kind of very vague ideas about quitting smoking, or they just feeling that they are being pushed to do it. We want them to identify one single strong reason why they are quitting smoking. If they have so many different reasons, or if they just tell us, I don't have reasons to quit smoking, I think I'm just gonna do it, and it all depends on my willpower. But willpower could be changed and fluctuate every day, and it could be affected by the weather or something that happened that can change their willpower. So we want them to, that's why we want them to find out what are their motivations and what are the reasons that can keep them going to quit smoking. And we will have them to write it down and also to reveal it to see how do they feel about that. And then planning is very important. So we also spend quite a lot of times to talk to the clients and ask them, what are the time that they feel they really want to have a cigarette? And I remember one of the clients that they tells us that whenever in the morning, when they first wake up, before doing anything, he just wanted to light up a cigarette. He said, this is a cigarette that I cannot give up. I can give up all the cigarettes for the whole day, but this is a one last cigarette that I cannot give up. So these are some of the situations that we want them to think about, every single details that can help us to help them to identify it and to hopefully find the solutions to help them cope with it. And there are some really high common triggers, which is the stress and also craving, and if they are experiencing some emotional situations, like if they experience like divorce or accident, and if they're being with the other smokers, usually these are the times that they're easily to go back to smoke. So we want them to think ahead what they can do to prevent going back to smoking, things happened. And if they, for the follow-up phone calls, if they tell us that, I went back to smoking last Friday, and we won't blame them. We just want to help them to get it through, and we want to encourage them to keep going forward. So even though they tell us that they went back to smoking or they feel that this is not a good time to quit smoking, we want them to talk about it. Why did they do it? And we will ask them, if you decided to quit smoking again, what did you think you can do it better? Or if the same situations comes up, what you can do? And help them to think about all the different solutions. And then set a quit date and find a date that they feel comfortable. And also before the quit date, we will send them a remind calls and to ask them maybe give away all their cigarettes or to clean up the ashtrays, clean up the room, clean up all the triggers, things that may trigger them to quit smoking. And a lot of times clients, they would think that they can do it because they feel they have the strong willpower, but we also want to let them know craving is not last forever and the urges is not going to last forever. We tell them if you have the plan, that's when the cravings hits on you. If you can do something to switch your focus, then usually 7 to 10 minutes after, you will be fine. So that's why we spend a lot of time on planning and also set a quit date to have them do some preparation work before the actual quit date comes. That can help too. And since we don't charge them anything, it's free, and they don't need to come to our center, so they don't have to arrange the transportations, or for people that they have children, they don't need to worry about the childcare service. They can just give us a call at the time that they feel convenient or at a comfortable place. And it's a one-on-one, and we don't see them, and they don't see us. So it makes some people feel it's secure, and they feel that there is some kind of privacy left to them. So there are some of the people they like about the telephone counseling, because it helps them to feel that they can still protect themselves without exposing too much to the others. And ask, advise, and refer. And I'm sure you all have already asked your patients whether they are smokers. If they said yes, and you can advise them to quit smoking, just one single sentence, make it a priority to quit, it's important for your health. And then refer your patients to California Smokers Helpline, give them our 1-800-NO-BUDS card or the information, or you can do the online web referral as well. And because all of these advice and things that you do can help your patients to make the quit attempt a serious quit attempt. And here has another question that I want to ask you. How many quit attempts a smoker has to make before they can successfully quit smoking? Anybody want to guess? How many of you would say 1 to 5? Okay, how about 6 to 10? Okay, how about 10 to 15? 15 to 20? Okay, so the answer is, on average, 10 to 12 attempts to quit successfully. So this number is not a very encouraging number. And of course, if your patients are telling you, oh my goodness, this is my first time, then I don't want you to share with them. You still have 12 times to go before you can successfully quit. So this is an average number. And this is a number that for us to have an idea that they can quit smoking successfully. It just takes time. So that's why every quit attempt counts. And every quit attempt, information that they share with us, share with you, will help them to become a smoke-free person in the next time. So we definitely want to make our clients feel that they're not a loser, even though they go back to smoking. We just want them to know that there are just different ways that they may have to try to become a smoke-free person. And I mentioned earlier, we do have some online services that the patients and the smokers can take advantage of. We have the live chat option, and we also have a texting program. They can put down their first name, last name, and their phone numbers. Even though they are not our clients, everybody can do that, and they will receive the helpful tips every day about quitting smoking. And then for people that they want to quit smoking, but if they are thinking that they do not have the time to make a phone call, but they would like to register themselves first, they can also go to our website to register themselves, to put down all their information, and then put down the time that they would like the counselors to call them, then we can also do that one. And we have the free helpline materials and resources. Here are some of our new postcards, brochures, red cards, and the wallet cards that we developed for the clients that they are trying to quit smoking. And since we have a project that is going on with First Five California, so for smokers that are pregnant, and they are smokers who are living with young children, 0 to 5, they may be eligible for receiving the free patches. So if your clients, your patients that are in one of those categories, this is additional information you can share with them. But since we do have different projects going on from time to time, so it's always good to have your smoking patients to call us, and the counselors will let them know whether they are eligible for some of the other nicotine replacement therapy. But so far, this is the free nicotine patches that we were provided to the First Five California related population. And then we also have fact sheets that you can download on our website. And there are some useful topics that share about how to help your patients to quit smoking effectively, how to cope with stress, or how to quit smoking without gaining weight. Those are the useful informations. And besides giving the brochures or the go cards to the patients, and sometimes we have to admit that when the patients receive that cards, just like I said, they may not want to quit smoking. After they got it, leave the office and go back to their house, they may say, oh, I forget the number, I lost the brochure, I just don't want to call. So when they see you during that time, treat it as a golden opportunity. And if they're really motivated, want to quit smoking, and I think you can also do a proactive referral. And here are some of the options for you. And we have an electronic health record referrals. And right now, all the UC campuses, they have integrated the EHR referrals with the helpline services, so they can submit their referrals through the EHR. And then once we received it, of course, they have to ask the patients and they give the verbal consent, and then they send it to us and it gives us the permissions to call the patients. And then there is another way to refer the patients, that is the web-based referrals. And here are the websites for you to go to the web-based referral page, or you can go to our website and click on those. And first of all, you have to register your organization, and this is also on the web-based referral page. And then provide the information that we requested. And after we received it, we will approve your registrations via emails. And then once you receive that email, that means that you are on our list and you can start referring your patients. And then, so the good things about the web-based referral it's besides you can quickly refer the patients to us and we can contact the patients quickly. You can also get a report, and this is the report looks like. It's a sample report. And after 6 months, you can send us an email and let us know how many patients you have referred in the past 6 months, and then we let you know that this is X number of total referrals we have got, and then we divided into three groups, reached, no contact, and attempting. And then among the reached populations, we will also let you know how many of them actually received the counseling, or they chose just to receive the materials, or they refuse the service. So these reports can give you an idea what are the effectiveness or your smoking cessation efforts in the past 6 months, and to also let you know how you can help your patients to get more help to quit smoking. And so besides California Smokers Helpline Services and the resources, here are some of the new laws about the tobacco products and smoking that I would like to share with you. Starting in June this year, there is a new smoking law, and they have a new expanded definitions of it to include the electronic cigarettes and the vaping pen. That's also consider its smoking behavior. So electronic cigarettes use is not allowed anywhere. Smoking is prohibited, including the public transit, worksite, restaurants, schools, and playgrounds. And if you want to find out more information and the details about these laws, you can always go to the tobaccofreeca.com. These laws does give us an idea that for people that they are no longer smoking, but if they switch it to electronic cigarettes and they think that is safer and it is different than smoking, but under these new law, they are also prohibited where the smoking, non-smoking, where smoking is not allowed. So this is something that I think it may be good to share with the patients as well. And then the expanded definitions of the tobacco products. Here are the tobacco products that are. These are the things that they are also considered as tobacco products, included the electronic cigarettes and also the some other electronic nicotine products that are here. And here are the helpline languages line number. If you cannot remember all of these, that's fine. You can just have your patients call 1-800-NO-BUDS, and we can always do the transfer to any of your patients. And that would bring it to the end of my presentation. So any questions? Nasal spray.
Yeah. It's not available in the United States yet. Do you know anything about that?
That one, we don't really have that many requests about using the nasal spray, and but we do also have the information if people they choose to use it, but I'm not quite sure when is it gonna be available. But I thought they were available at a point. Yeah, and that was like back in 2000 something. That was the time. But then we didn't really have that much people ask us about using the nasal spray or express the interest of using the nasal spray. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. I will just let you know that a few things. We do have a Trudeau Society. It's a medical professional meeting. It's welcome to any other healthcare professionals. And when it has put a plug in, you can join today. And two, the first topic for 2017 is on e-cigarettes. So, I think that this is a very timely area since. Smoking cessation is really crucial for the management of COPD patients. And I can echo what you've mentioned because I think many of you recall, or to paraphrase Mark Twain, Samuel Clemens, he's always said that smoking is the easiest thing to do. Stopping smoking is the easiest thing to do because I've done it 100 times. So he did it 100 times instead of 12. So it's my pleasure to then proceed with our next speaker. Thank you. Our next speaker is Davis Park. He's the director of the Front Porch Center for Innovation and Well-Being. He has 15 years of program development and technology implementation and employment for seniors in low-income and underserved communities. He's responsible for the development and oversight of the center's technologies and initiatives and programs. And technology is actually the forefront of improving compliance. As you can see, Cherrie mentioned telephone, texting, and the web. And so I think that I want to welcome Davis here to provide a presentation on COPD self-management and telemedicine.
Good afternoon, morning. My name is Davis, and I'm the director of the Front Porch Center for Innovation and Well-Being. And I don't live in this space. I don't really work or get deeply involved with people who have COPD, even though we may address some portion of the population that do have this condition. But I kind of want to hear today talk a little bit more about some of the work that we do and hopefully inspire you to kind of look at different interventions in the prevention and treatment of this condition that you may come across as you work with your patients. So just to kind of give you some background, let me first start off. I've got no relevant financial interest, arrangement, or affiliation with any organizations or groups related to commercial products or services to be discussed today. So let me kind of give you some background about my organization. Front Porch is a family of communities. We are a senior service provider. So we operate and manage full service retirement communities throughout California. We operate 10 of these in the state. We also manage about two dozen affordable housing communities. And so we touch a population of about 5,000 lives every day. And so my work within Front Porch is overseeing the Center for Innovation and Well-Being. And our mission is to explore innovative uses of technology to empower the lives of individuals, especially as we age. And so my work is embedded within the organization that provides senior living. So specifically, a lot of the things that we do is we look at the landscape in technology and innovation and see how those kinds of solutions can impact the lives of the people that we're serving. So we really have a broad kind of reach and range of interest when it comes to looking at technologies. We look at everything from cell phone texting for medication management. We're interested in embedded sensors to help using analytics to help prevent and look at analytics to prevent emergencies before they occur, whether it be a fall or someone who looks like they're about to land in an emergency room. We're really excited about telehealth and telemedicine as a means of providing services to people where they're most comfortable, in their homes and their communities. We're really excited about things as simple as like Nintendo Wii Bowling. We think that that's a really great way to engage with people, bring people out of their rooms and out with communities and getting some physical activity out of it as well. And so what I'm going to be talking a little bit today about are some of the examples of these technologies and innovations that we have been using, testing, and deployed. The sort of model that we take is sort of, we're a pseudo like research laboratory of sorts. And so when we look at an intervention, we pilot test it, we set up pre and post measurements, we go through focus groups and surveys with the people who are participating in our pilots. And then we look for scaling and business opportunities. We look to see if this thing is really successful, what are the steps that we're going to need to take in order to bring this to many more communities and populations? So I kind of want to start off by talking a little bit about our remote patient monitoring program. Is anyone familiar with RPM? So remote patient monitoring basically is a way of monitoring someone's vitals in their homes. So, you know, you can ask a patient, you know, please, I want you to take this blood pressure, take your blood pressure, I want you to follow your oxygen levels. You know, if you're diabetic, we want you to take your blood sugar levels. And they have this equipment at home that's then collected through the cloud, that's then monitored by a caregiver, or by, in our case, it's with a call center. So basically, you can set up your parameters, you know, because not everyone is the same. Everyone has different blood pressure readings. Everyone has different sugar levels. And if once that trending pattern is established, then you could put flags and triggers on them. So once that person crosses that threshold, then a caregiver can alert or just follow up with that patient saying, hey, it looks like your blood pressure is a little high today. Are you okay? And then in one of our instances, one of our residents replied, oh, I ate that donut I shouldn't have last night. And so then they begin to self-manage their conditions. They begin to tell themselves, you know, I don't want that call, or I don't want to have to be reprimanded by that. They don't get reprimanded, but I don't want to have to be told, you know, that I'm not being careful. So we actually have gone through a pilot program where we deploy to about 90 residents who are both living within our affordable housing communities and who are going to senior service centers, and we found statistically significant reductions in blood pressure. People are actually like listening to their care providers, and their care providers are saying, wow, like I didn't, you know, this is great, you actually have reduced your blood pressure. And we are also looking, we also found that people have had a very high acceptance of this kind of intervention, you know, in addressing their chronic conditions. And people were really happy. They're really thrilled to have this kind of, this sort of solution in their homes. And, you know, they think technology is really cool, and especially technology, it matters to them. Right, it's not just about giving someone a smartphone or a set of devices, but it's like explaining to them how this can actually help with their overall health and well-being. We also saw some really positive behavior changes as well. Another program that, as part of our telehealth and telemedicine initiatives and piloting and rolling out throughout our communities, has been in telehealth consultations. And in our early project, when we first launched this program, we did some telehealth consultation with a podiatrist. And you know, some people may wonder, well, like, don't you have to like touch the patient's hand, touch the patient's foot, and examine it? And yeah, in some cases, but a lot of times they don't really need to actually handle someone's foot. And so, what we had done is that we conducted over 30 sessions with people in affordable housing. Right, so we're talking about people who like are safety net patients, people who really have a hard time, you know, traveling across town in order to see their specialist. And so that's made even more difficult by the fact that they may have trouble walking, right? And so, you know, a visit to the ER or to specialists or to a doctor's office is really, really stressful when we're talking about this segment of the population. We had really high satisfaction rates. People were like, wow, this is great. I can just walk downstairs, take the elevator down, and see this person. And people have also responded that this kind of intervention communication with their specialist or physician or care provider is much more preferable than having to go to that office, sit in a waiting room, and go in a cold environment. This way, they're actually in a place where they're already more comfortable. This is a really short clip. Do you mind if we play it?
Why do you think I can't do that myself? What's the problem with that?
Because she can go from it, she can cut herself.
So you can't see the patient. The patient is off screen here, but you can see there's an interpreter there, and we have the podiatrist on the other end. And so the and also on our end, on our side, the patient, and we have a tech, a med tech, who's there to kind of provide some general assistance if it's necessary. And then we also provide, you know, if there's also follow-ups, then we definitely make those recommendations too. Just to kind of let you know, we're not a health provider. We are a senior living community service provider. We work with these different organizations and groups and partner up with them to provide and deliver these services to the communities that we work with. Another aspect of our telemedicine and telehealth program is in telemental health. And we had recognized, and we've recognized for a long time, that mental health conditions, like the mild and severe mental health conditions, especially when it comes to depression, is a big problem within affordable housing. In fact, it's a big problem in many places, but we feel it acutely in senior living and in affordable housing. So what we had done with a very small grant, we implemented this program where we deployed iPads to affordable housing communities and connected them with providers. And so we work with over 30 residents, provide over 250 hours of telemental health counseling and support. And this was like so amazing. It was transformational for a lot of people because a lot of them had never spoken to someone about some of the issues. And you know, there's a lot of goal setting that happened in some of these sessions. And like close to 100, well, let's say 95% of those who we had surveys in this program report that these were really positive experiences. So again, the uptake when it comes to telehealth and telemedicine can be significant if it's meaningful to the people who it's serving. We found really some extraordinary kind of changes in people who are part of this program in serving people who are Korean monolingual and Spanish speaking as well. And again, these are just very simple iPads that we deploy to the communities that we work with. So I want to kind of start off about this story with a toy named Biscuit. And Biscuit was an interactive robot toy that came out about 5 or 6 years ago. And these things cost about $500. But they stopped continuing making them because they were so expensive and because there just really wasn't a market for them. Through some conversations we had with some other senior living providers, with another senior living provider who happened to pick one up at a garage sale, brought it into her memory care neighborhood, and he saw, wow, like there are all these really wonderful changes. You know, they saw engagement, so we said, we got to go get one of these. But we couldn't get one of these brand new. We bought it off of eBay for $200, got sent over to one of our memory care neighborhoods and said, hey, tell us what you think about this. And so they started using this within their community and started bringing it, introducing to people in memory care, and they're like, oh, this is so wonderful. And again, mind you, this is a toy robot, okay? And it kind of barks, and it kind of does this panting sound, and it moves its head and its tail. And so we're like, great, this is great, it's wonderful engagement. However, like one day, one of the CNAs had dropped off Biscuit in one of the residence rooms. This guy was like, you know, tall guy, really big, and he loved Biscuit. And so she left Biscuit with him. She left and came back about 5 minutes later, and he was just really upset. I mean, he was like kind of shaking and obviously very anxious, and Biscuit was on the floor. And she said, what had happened? And he said, dogs do not belong on tables. So apparently he had whacked this thing off the table, and it stopped working. And, well, I mean, it was sort of like sputtering, you know, and when we would bring this to other people, to other residents, they'd be like, you know what, you don't want to talk to me anymore because it stopped responding to the person's like conversations, and it kind of wouldn't sit up anymore. Its front legs were broken. It had propped up by a pillow. So I said, okay, well, I think we've had enough. This is actually producing more anxiety than anything. So we actually had to quietly put Biscuit away. So this then kind of led us to Paro. And Paro is a baby harp seal. Has anyone heard of or seen Paro before? A couple of you, okay. So Paro, and in fact, you may see it in there's like an episode in The Simpsons, and Paro's appeared in like a show called Master of None on a Netflix special. And so we've been following Paro for a little while. Paro's been around for about a decade. And there have been subsequent generations, you know, since its first implementation. And Paro is a device that's specifically designed for nursing homes and older adult care environments. And so when we first kind of looked at this thing, it was like, this is just absolutely ridiculous. You know, who is going to go out and buy a baby harp robot seal for about $7,000, no less, right? So this is crazy. But when I first saw this thing, and I've got one up over here, when I first saw this thing, I was just completely sucked in. And I just like, okay, I got to get one of these. We got to at least try it out. So then we started kind of introducing this to our care environment and bringing this to our memory care neighborhood, and we were just completely astounded with the engagement. People who would not come out of their rooms to eat or socialize, when we would introduce PAR to them, they'd suddenly start engaging, and they suddenly begin to develop an appetite. And people who have not spoken in weeks, if not months, all of a sudden were speaking in clear, crystal clear sentences. It's the strangest thing. We just don't know how this happens or why it works, but the important thing is that we get engagement. And when this is used around a table for memory therapy and conversations to kind of elicit people's past and histories that haven't been discussed in a long time, it's really a wonderful thing to see. We are also finding that Paro's use is an FDA-cleared device. And so we're exploring about ways on how we can actually get reimbursed for some of the work that we're doing PAR. We're currently looking at physical therapy reimbursements and how these kinds of devices can be used to help, again, promote treatment and engagement among people who are using it. We just recently found out that one of our communities. So we pilot tested this in one of our memory care neighborhoods and skilled nursing. The outcomes are so fantastic that we really wanted to scale this. We brought this to six other memory care neighborhoods and within our front porch communities. But one of the things that we found out was that. In one of our conversations was that this is actually being used for falls prevention. We're like, what do you mean falls prevention? And so one of the care providers said, we're finding that people who are in wheelchairs or sitting down and who are suddenly anxious but who've forgotten that they can no longer walk are trying to get up. And when they get up, they obviously stumble. So what we're doing is that we're handling Paro to them, and so they're actually still in their chairs, and then they calm down. The drop in anxiety levels when we start to use Paro, we have just been so dramatic. We've used Paro to bring people back into their homes while they're pacing or they're sundowning or wandering the halls. It's been really effective, not just for the residents of our communities, but for caregivers as well. For caregivers, it's extremely helpful when we say, well, what would happen if we took this away, because we can no longer pay for it. They're like, do not do that. They're saying, this is actually helping us. This helps our work. It helps with further engagement, and it reduces the anxiety levels within our communities. We've also found that it actually has been reducing medications and dispensing of medications, especially with respect to psychotropics. And we're also using this as pain redirection tools as well. So we're finding that people are actually needing fewer medications as a result of interaction with Paro. So, I mentioned that those things were about $7,000. And Hasbro, remember the story about Biscuit? They've actually kind of come around, and now they're looking to, they've started to manufacture a smaller version and a much more affordable one, and it's called Joy for All. They're called My Pet Companions. And they actually have, they're trying to make themselves more accessible to market because they see where this is going. They see that there's a huge opportunity when it comes to using these sorts of devices in senior care and senior living. I'll have these devices here if you want to kind of play and interact with them. They're kind of fun and pretty neat to, you can just take your selfies with them later. So. Another program that we've been working on is called Music and Memory, and this is such a simple, and like, you know, we always say, well, why didn't I think about that? And Music and Memory is basically their iPods with individualized playlists, like customized playlists, whereby you can load like a music player, it doesn't have to be an iPod, with songs and music that resonate with that person. This has been really effective in our ADHCs, adult daycare health centers, and within our some memory care neighborhoods, whereby we collect information about that individual, look to see what really impacts that person. Like there was maybe that person really loved Jailhouse Rock by Elvis Presley, and you put that on, and that person, the reactions have been varied, but we found like the most profound impact among those who can no longer speak or have trouble speaking has been like phenomenal. And there's actually a movie out called Alive Inside that's actually available, I think, on Netflix and video as well. But the outcomes from our pilot studies have been, again, so convincing in terms of positive move improvements. Staff have witnessed like the easing of pain and other positive outcomes. There have also been reduction in abusive and anxious behaviors, and people tend to be more socially engaged. So this has been such a cheap way of kind of like looking at how we can use this sort of intervention in bringing people again 2 to 4 and getting them involved in their self-care. Virtual reality is another really exciting space that we're getting involved in. Has anyone ever played with a VR headset? Okay, like maybe one or two. I encourage you to like seek them out. If there's an opportunity for you to try it, please do it. I mean, you know, a lot. It's not just about first-person shooter games anymore. You know, we have been kind of looking at this over the last couple years to see how something like VR can be used as a tool for engagement, for people, for our caregivers to use for pain management, for relaxation, to reduce anxiety. There's a whole host of potential applications in this space, and it's actually making like quite a lot of inroads with respect to the healthcare care arena. We're specifically looking at how this can address depression. We want to see how this can connect people, like socially connect, because our work is about social engagement and building those connections and relationships, because the more that we're socially engaged and the more that we interact with those around us, the less likely we'll die. That's the truth, right? So social isolation is a real problem, and things can only snowball from there. So VR is one opportunity that we're looking at. We've been working with researchers from USC's OTPT department and school to look at how VR can be used as a means of stroke rehabilitation and rebuilding neural pathways. We're also working with content curators who can look for and specify certain content that may resonate with someone who may want to go to Hawaii, who's never been to Hawaii but can no longer walk. Right? It's all about, again, giving people like some dignity, you know, in their lives, and providing them with experiences that really make sense to them. This is a really short clip that we had done with during one of our test pilots.
Yeah.
Oh boy. This is lovely. Oh boy. Oh, look at that.
The castle, yeah.
So we are seeing, like, you know, people like come out of these virtual reality experiences like just completely refreshed, and that you notice there's a very different kind of mood change and kind of once they take these things off. And so, you know, we are absolutely like committed and thrilled about what the upcoming sort of offerings there are in this space, and we believe that this is going to be much bigger than again just video games. There's a, you know, there, it's it, we're looking closely at how Facebook's acquiring of Oculus Rift, one of the major VR kind of vendors, is going to really change the way we connect with one another through social networking and connecting with families who may be across the country in different geography. So thank you.
There's time for questions, if anybody has questions. So I have a question. So I think this is, the VA is getting into telemedicine, and I think that one of the things that struck me as a potential is to instruct patients on how to use their medications or compliance with routines. I don't know if that's ever been used or discussed with her.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, medication management is a huge deal, you know, especially in the populations that we're working with. You know, very typically people 65 and over have like at least about a dozen medications that they need to follow. We actually have been working with UC Irvine, and soon with UC San Diego in delivering telemedicine services, and one of those services is in medication reconciliation. So we're connecting them with pharmacists, with a pharmacist through an iPad, and just kind of going over like their cocktail of meds and kind of explain to them what these things do. Or maybe you may not need these meds, or like potentially, you know, looking at these the group of their medications and explain to them, you know, these two probably are harmful together. Right, so, and you have to make sure you space out like how you take them. So we are looking at, we have been looking at telepharmaceutical consultations as under med management programs through telehealth.
I wonder if you try to do these talking parrot puppets, you can talk to them, they talk back to you, and it's only $25.
Talking parrots, yeah. Well, some of us are just, I mean, we're already creeped out by robots, but those that actually talk back to you and human voice kind of might be a little. It is, yeah. There are a lot of like really great kind of ideas that are kind of coming out right now, but those are examples of some of the innovations in the space. All right, great, thank you.
Thank you. That was great. Right on time. I also want to just remind all that there will be a panel discussion at the end where we'll have our speakers up on the podium, the table there, where we can discuss, ask other questions and actually anything related to the conference of COPD. It's my pleasure to introduce our next speaker. It's Christopher B. Cooper, and Chris is, and I go back quite a long time. And actually, we won't say how long, but we do remember those ATS guidelines, and they were like 20-some-odd years ago. But he's Emeritus Professor of Medicine and Physiology at the Geffen School of Medicine, and he's also Director of the Exercise Physiology Lab. Currently works also now as a global medical expert for GlaxoSmithKline. His training is in London. And came and did a doctoral degree on this thesis. It was also at Harvard UCLA where I think I first met you. But he's as a Fulbright scholar, where he went on to pursue and advance a field exercise physiology. He received the Shermelikov Faculty Award from the David School of School of Medicine. Has like over 30 years of experience in both exercise physiology and COPD and asthma. So he's lectured extensively, and I'm certainly pleased to welcome Dr. Cooper to the podium.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for your kind introduction. Guy, and I remember those days when we ran the Trudeau Society, the Southern California Pulmonary Research Conference out in Palm Springs. So that takes us back a while. So I've been asked today to speak about new medications in the treatment of COPD, and as you've heard, as well as continuing to work at UCLA, engaged in research with grants from NIH, COPD Foundation, and Equinox Fitness Clubs, I also teach the students, and I'm working part-time for GlaxoSmithKline, so that's an important disclosure this morning, but I work more in the scientific and educational environment at GSK and not really in the promotional field. I'll try to keep my presentation this morning balanced as far as meeting CME requirements is concerned. Now, I'm going to talk about the need for earlier diagnosis in COPD and also briefly review guidelines and see what direction they're taking us in the management of the disease, and we'll look at specific therapies. Frankly, we have new therapies of the classes with which we're familiar. We have some novel treatments in the pipeline, but nothing really newly emerging in the COPD field. So I'll talk a lot about new bronchodilator therapies and the role of inhaled corticosteroids. So to begin with, to set the scene, COPD is a classic example of gene-environment interaction. It begins with a genetic predisposition. There's a latency period during which there are significant exposures to inhaled particulates and fumes, and then the disease begins. But it's important to realize that it goes through numerous steps of biochemical and cellular events and early structural damage, before we can even pick this up radiographically or identify physiological abnormalities. And the clinical manifestations of the disease are really rather late on in this time course. So when we rely upon an FEV1-FVC ratio less than 70% to define COPD, we're missing a very important early stage in the progression of the disease. And when we evaluate our patients based on symptoms and risk, we're really looking at almost end-stage manifestations of the disease in these terms. Now, the time base is uncertain because it varies with each individual patient. But we and Mark de Kramer and I did an analysis some years ago where we looked at the data from the TORCH study. That was a study looking at long-acting beta agonist, inhaled corticosteroid, their combination, and individual components versus placebo. And the UPLIFT trial, a four-year study, looking at the comparison of tiotropium with placebo. And regardless of treatment allocation, these were the rates of decline of FEV1 in the treatment arms in these studies, admittedly over only 3 or 4 years, but it reminds us that this is just a small snapshot in the lifetime or lifespan of the progression of COPD, and it doesn't look as if those treatment interventions had a dramatic effect on rate of decline. But when we break these patients down into gold spirometric stages, moderate, severe, and very severe, what is interesting is that the rate of decline of FEV1 seems to be faster in the patients with gold spirometric stage 2 or moderate disease. And there are other publications now that have really verified this opinion that there is more action earlier on. There's more loss of lung function and other clinical developments, and these tend to level out. It's rather contrary to the Fletcher-Pitot hypothesis, where the rate of decline of FEV1 was supposed to accelerate as the disease got more severe. So this really points to the need for an earlier diagnosis, and the previous slide suggested that relying on an FEV1-FVC ratio to define COPD is really not good enough. Now, more evidence points to the fact that there are patients who don't necessarily meet the spirometric criteria for COPD but still have disease burden. This is data from the Spiromic study, which UCLA participates in, and these are patients who are current or former smokers with preserved spirometry. The editor of the New England Journal insisted on this terminology, or preserved pulmonary function. But frankly, if one was to measure airway resistance, I can't imagine it would be normal in these individuals because they have abnormalities on high-resolution chest CT that are consistent with airway wall thickening. And furthermore, if they have a symptom burden by a CAT score over 10, they have exacerbations, even exacerbations requiring antibiotics, glucocorticoids, or a combination of both, and sometimes hospitalization. So there is a burden of disease in people with preserved spirometry, and this needs to be recognized and treated. And I'll come back to this point. So where is GOLD taking us? Just recently, GOLD has released the new guideline for 2017, but it's not called a guideline anymore. It's called a GOLD strategy document, perhaps because it has been criticized in the past for not providing guidance. And I must admit that I was one of the people who did that. But what does GOLD tell us in 2017? Firstly, the definition is changing. So whereas it was considered a progressive disease with inflammatory response in the airways, there's now an emphasis on symptoms and a recognition that this is due to airway and or alveolar abnormalities caused by significant exposure to noxious particles or gases. So sort of reading the tea leaves, if you like, in the teacup, we might think that GOLD is beginning to recognize these structural abnormalities that can be seen earlier on and the need to recognize the symptom burden. This will lead, I think, to a new definition of COPD in the future. Now, the other significant change with the GOLD guidelines is that while diagnosis still relies upon FEV1-FVC ratio, and that is problematic in my opinion, FEV1 spirometric grading has been taken out of the ABCD risk stratification. It's still recommended to grade the spirometric severity of COPD and also as a prognostic indicator, but when it comes to evaluating risk, we're now solely reliant on knowing exacerbation history. And assessing symptoms, we still have a recommendation to use the Modified Medical Research Council questionnaire or the CAT score. And the CAT, actually, having been somewhat skeptical about the CAT years ago, I think that the recent information from Spiromics has validated its use in identifying patients with persistent symptoms. So the GOLD treatment suggestions, if we call them suggestions now, for grade A disease, low symptoms and low risk of exacerbation, suggest a bronchodilator. Terrific. Thank you to the GOLD Science Committee for that wisdom. But this is only about 10% of patients. And you try one, if it doesn't work, you try another. But what's more important is GOLD grade B, high level of symptoms or persistent symptoms, one should think of moving quickly towards a LAMA-LABA combination, dual long-acting bronchodilators. And I'll present some evidence that shows convincingly that this combination therapy is better than the individual long-acting monocomponents. And GOLD grade B might be about 60% of patients. What about GOLD grade C? This is the most intriguing category, but the science committee thinks it's only about 1% of patients. So perhaps we shouldn't be worrying about this too much. But the fact is that there are some patients with low level of symptoms who've had exacerbations, and they might be on LAMA-LABA combination therapy, or they might be on a combination of LABA and inhaled corticosteroid. And I'll come back to this point, because if you have a patient you think has low symptom burden but has an exacerbation, which direction do you go here? Regardless of that consideration, the majority of COPD patients follow this pathway from A to B to D, and it's really one long-acting bronchodilator, two long-acting bronchodilators, and then triple therapy. That'll be my concluding message from this talk. And here in the stepping up from LAMA-LABA combination therapy to LAMA-LABA ICS, we have some new data for triple therapy and a single inhaler. Beyond that, we might consider drugs like reflumilast or macrolides for people with lower airway bacterial colonization and persistent exacerbations. But GOLD is now beginning to focus on triple therapy as the foundational therapy for GOLD grade D. So let's look briefly at some evidence for dual bronchodilator therapy. And here is an accumulation of studies looking at tiotropium plus olodaterol compared with tiotropium, looking at glycopyrronium plus indicatrol compared with tiotropium, or umeclidinium and valantrol compared with tiotropium. All the dual long-acting bronchodilator therapies are superior in terms of improvement in trough FEV1 compared with a single long-acting bronchodilator, tiotropium. And I suppose tiotropium is a reasonable comparator because it's probably became the most widely prescribed long-acting monotherapy for COPD management worldwide. Now, there aren't any direct head-to-head comparisons at the present time, but there have been several interesting studies using network meta-analysis to try and create indirect treatment comparisons. And this is basically how these work. There are a number of studies that might, for example, have compared glycopyrronium indicatrol with tiotropium or with placebo, various combinations. Mathematically, one can derive some treatment differences by this technique. And if we look at trough FEV1, the striking comparison, these would be milliliter differences, are with dual bronchodilator therapies compared with placebo. Frankly, you know, when we get down to comparing the dual bronchodilators with each other, the FEV1 differences aren't very great, and that'll be clearer from another study that I will show you. Schluter's study also looked at SGRQ. Frankly, these numbers, I'll just interpret them by saying SGRQ changes were generally comparable, and so too were changes in the TDI, the Transitional Dyspnea Index. These were responder analyses. This poster presented at the European Respiratory Society this year is another network meta-analysis with a similar approach. And again, I find this quite a good reference to remind me of all the different clinical trials that have been done comparing these therapies. Again, when you look at the results in a forest plot, and this is with umeclidinium and valantrol being the comparator, obviously much better than placebo or monotherapy, but when you get down to comparisons with other dual long-acting bronchodilators, really not a significant difference, except perhaps in the case of aclidinium formoterol. And if we look at SGRQ, again, similar conclusions. When we compare different combinations of dual long-acting bronchodilators, really no effect, no difference, and certainly what small differences are seen here in mean values are within the minimum clinically important difference for SGRQ. And we see a similar pattern with transitional dyspnea index. So that's where we are right now. Whether there'll be further insights from head-to-head comparisons, who knows? I suspect we won't discover anything that we don't already know. There is a need for other endpoints in evaluating the efficacy of bronchodilator therapy. One which is of considerable interest is exercise performance, and it looks as if the COPD Biomarker Qualification Consortium is heading in the direction of picking some form of exercise endurance time as a measure that might eventually convince the FDA to be a meaningful outcome for clinical trials. There have been some studies with umeclidinium valantrol, and this is one presentation from the British Thoracic Society meeting in London in 2015, which showed a 16.4% gain in endurance shuttle walk time with that combination therapy. Here's a more recent and very interesting study looking at tiotropium and olodaterol. And this was a study presented at ERS in 2016 as well, where Thierry Troosters and colleagues implemented a program where every patient had motivational therapy by behavioral modification, and that in itself improved endurance time for a shuttle walk, an endurance shuttle walk test. Tiotropium alone didn't really make much of a difference compared with the behavioral modification intervention. But then when you got to adding dual bronchodilator therapy and dual bronchodilator therapy with an exercise training program, you got a step up to maximum effect. And, you know, I think this is really very interesting in that it points to the fact that exercise performance, particularly physical activity, it's a behavior, really, as much as a clinical endpoint. And so these behavioral modifications are very important. Now, this study gained a lot of publicity earlier this year, the FLAME study, which compares indicatrol and glycopyrronium, two long-acting bronchodilators, a long-acting muscarinic antagonist and a long-acting beta agonist, with a combination, which we're quite familiar with, of salmeterol and fluticasone. And this showed that there was a benefit in terms of reducing exacerbations from dual long-acting bronchodilators compared with LABOR ICS. And this was true for all of the patients and when you broke them down into moderate or severe and severe exacerbations, with about 20% reductions here. Now, you might say, well, that's not surprising because we know bronchodilator therapy reduces exacerbations, and giving two bronchodilators as compared with one, you're going to get more bronchodilator benefits. And the role of the inhaled corticosteroid, you know, is still brought into question. Now, if you look at this study, there's been two subsequent analyses. Well, one actually was included in the original paper by Wodicha, but there is commentary about this, that the paper says that there's no difference in the benefit from the dual long-acting bronchodilators, regardless of whether patients have high or low eosinophil counts. But actually, if you look at the data and you look at the patients with the lower eosinophil counts, there is a 20% benefit from the dual long-acting bronchodilators. If you look at patients with higher eosinophil counts, there's only a 15% benefit. So the differential benefit of dual bronchodilator therapy over LABOR ICS is greater if patients do not have high eosinophil counts. And I'll come back to this. Now, other sub-analyses of FLAME shown at the ERS meeting recently. If you look here, patients who are younger tended to have a greater differential benefit from LAMA-LABA therapy versus LABOR ICS. Whether or not people responded to short-acting bronchodilators, responsiveness or reversibility, if you like, didn't make any difference, really, to the differential benefit. So what is the role of LABOR ICS? This is a study, I think, that is really interesting. There have been many LABOR ICS studies, but this year we've seen the Salford Lung study from the UK, and it's a comparative efficacy effectiveness study rather than an efficacy study. What is meant by that is there's a broad recruitment from the population in this city of Salford in northern England without rigid inclusion and exclusion criteria. And about half of the Salford population of COPD patients actually was enrolled in this study, about 2,300 patients. And if you looked at them, first of all, the proportion of men and women was about 50-50, which is what you'd expect. If you look at almost every other clinical trial that's performed in this area, there's 70 to 75% men participating. And it highlights the shortcomings of efficacy trials where inclusion and exclusion criteria are very rigid. And the conclusions might only truly be applicable to about 10% of the COPD population. This was different. But having described the recruitment process, FEV1 on average, 1.62 liters, really not too bad. But look, two or more exacerbations per year were reported by these patients. And all of this data was captured in an electronic health record. This is why the study was done in Salford, because they have one unified electronic health record that linked the major hospitals, 60 general practices, and 130 pharmacies. So all the prescriptions and all the data were captured in this study. And interestingly, the intervention was to give the combination of fluticasone, furoate, and valantrol versus usual care. So patients were on a whole variety of medications. Interestingly, in Salford, there were people with, let's say, COPD with preserved spirometry who were symptomatic and being given inhalers by their general practitioners. And a highlight on what actually happens in clinical practice versus what we think happens when we read guidelines. But if you used this combination therapy in a single inhaler versus usual care, there was an 8.4% reduction in exacerbations. And interestingly, about 50% of the patients enrolled in this study were on triple therapy at the time of enrollment and continued to have triple therapy, whether or not it included this combination or some other medications, which you might argue would dilute the beneficial effect that might be seen by this strategy. Well, one could say a lot more about this, but I'll move on. I really think it is a very interesting study pointing to a continuing important role of LABR ICS combination therapy in COPD management. Now, here's a really interesting story. Patients with higher eosinophil counts tend to respond better to inhaled corticosteroids. There's a great debate about whether there's a threshold. Should the eosinophil count be greater than or less than an absolute number or a percentage? But the truth of the matter is, if you look at this analysis, and this was with budesonide and formoterol, compared with formoterol alone, as you go to higher absolute eosinophil counts, you get much greater benefit in terms of reduced exacerbations from the combination of LABR ICS. Really interesting data. And here's another analysis looking at fluticasone, furoate, and valantrol compared with valantrol alone. And you see exactly the same thing. But Steve Pascoe here has used percentages of eosinophils. So Gold has recognized this. It says eosinophils may be a helpful biomarker in the management of COPD, but it's too early to make any firm recommendations. Now, of course, we must talk about risk as well as benefit, and the risk of inhaled corticosteroids on everyone's mind is the incidence of pneumonia, and this is well recognized. But putting it in perspective, this analysis of two pooled replicate studies comparing LABR plus ICS versus LABR show the number of exacerbations prevented compared with the number of episodes of pneumonia in excess of the comparator group. And there's clearly a much greater benefit in terms of preventing exacerbation events and as compared, at least numerically, as compared to the risk of pneumonia. And I think this is a way of quantifying a risk-benefit analysis that is on all of our minds that we have to think about when prescribing inhaled corticosteroids. Now, other evidence about eosinophils, interestingly, comes from the WISDOM trial. You may know that this was a study of inhaled corticosteroid withdrawal. Patients had a run-in on triple therapy and then were randomized to stop inhaled corticosteroids or continue. And interestingly, the primary outcome measure of this was that there was no difference in time to first exacerbation if you withdrew inhaled corticosteroids in all of the patients. But if you broke them down by eosinophil count, and Henrik Watts published this after the primary manuscript, you saw that the higher the eosinophil count, the more likely the patients were to relapse and have an exacerbation, suggesting that the inhaled corticosteroids had benefited those patients most who had the higher eosinophil counts. So triple therapy, this is the direction of travel, and there is emerging data. There's a recent paper by Dave Singh looking at this triple therapy, budesonide, formoterol, and glycopyrronium, versus budesonide and formoterol. And you can see these are changes in FEV1 from baseline 2 hours after drug administration So we're already got a change from baseline, but the difference between triple and dual therapy is around 80, 85 mils. And with that improvement in lung function with triple therapy, there is a 19.6% reduction in moderate and severe exacerbations. And that's about the magnitude of exacerbation reduction that one would expect with that degree of change of FEV1. Now, also presented at the ERS in London this year was data from the FULFILL study. This looks at fluticasone furoate, umeclidinium and valantrol versus budesonide and formoterol. So triple therapy versus a LAB or ICS. And there is a 35% reduction in exacerbations with triple therapy compared with LAB or ICS. And this is triple therapy. These two studies I've showed you are triple therapies available in a single inhaler. So an interesting space to watch. Supplemental oxygen, I included this slide before realizing that Janos Porszasz will talk about supplemental oxygen, but there's been a recent important study reported out, the LOT, long-term oxygen therapy trial study. In short, I won't preempt what Janos is going to say, but this was an inquiry as to whether patients with moderate hypoxemia, for example, during exercise and sleep, would benefit from provision of supplemental oxygen, and the primary outcome being death or first hospitalization from any cause. These were no different between the treatment groups, but I know Janos is going to talk more about the challenges of that study. New therapies, truly novel therapies, what about the field of biologics? We should watch the anti-IL-5 drugs because mepolizumab and rezolizumab have been approved for treatment of severe eosinophilic asthma. And there are ongoing clinical trials to see whether these drugs might benefit COPD patients who have higher eosinophil levels. There are the kinase inhibitors in clinical development. CXCR2 antagonists such as danirixin, which inhibit neutrophil migration, as opposed to eosinophil migration. So these are anti-inflammatory targeting drugs. And then there's the selective androgen receptor modifiers, of which there are a number now. Ostrine is something that is actually available and has been used to treat cancer cachexia. But patients, given that patients with COPD often develop debility with involuntary weight loss, loss of muscle mass or sarcopenia, and weakness, these sort of therapies and other anabolics, such as myostatin receptor inhibitors, are all being studied. So where does this all lead us today in terms of practical guidelines? Actually, Igor Bajuk-Terevich and I published this in 2015, and it was really a new approach to a clinical algorithm for the treatment of COPD that basically had three important features. One, clinical staging, as opposed to relying on FEV1. Two, early introduction of LAMA-LABA combination therapy, and recognizing this as foundational therapy for patients with persistent symptoms. And then beyond that, using clinical phenotyping to guide targeted therapy. Does this sound familiar? I think this is where gold is now heading. And as far as clinical phenotyping is concerned, in 2015, we suggested these clinical phenotypes and suggested guided therapy that might be applicable, such as roflumilast if one wanted additional bronchodilatation, azithromycin for those patients with lower airway bacterial colonization or bronchiectasis, the asthmatic phenotype, maybe the eosinophilic phenotype, ICS, frequent exacerbators, ICS, and other approaches. So taking the GOLD construct as Alvar Augusti and Leo Fabry did, but modifying it, perhaps this is the way we should be going, that for mild, moderate, and severe COPD, A, B, and D, we go from one long-acting bronchodilator to two, and then to triple therapy. And this enigmatic group, although there are only a few of the COPD patients, perhaps this is where eosinophil counts could guide us, such that if eosinophil counts were low, maybe LAMA-LABA therapy would be preferred. And actually, there's been a recent study by Ian Pavord suggesting that the risk of pneumonia may actually be higher in patients with lower eosinophil counts. So LAMA-LABA therapy would be a better choice for them. And conversely, if eosinophil count was high in GOLD's grade C, LABA plus ICS would be a good choice. But ultimately, all of these paths lead to triple therapy. So summarizing, there is an urgent need for earlier diagnosis in COPD and different diagnostic tools or criteria with which to make that diagnosis. We need novel endpoints, including exercise endpoints, and perhaps tests of provoked dyspnea, so we don't miss patients who have persistent symptoms. And the GOLD strategy document seems to be moving in a direction to recognize two important clinical decision points. Firstly, the earlier introduction of LAMA-LABA therapy to control persistent symptoms, so we're talking about symptom control, as we do in asthma, although in asthma, of course, we rely on inhaled corticosteroids to control symptoms. In COPD, we rely on bronchodilator therapy. And then the second clinical decision point is to recognize the step up to triple therapy for those who have breakthrough exacerbations in spite of LAMA-LABA dual bronchodilator therapy. And with that, I'll thank you very much for your attention.
Do we have time for a question before we break?
I'd like to ask, there's a category of patients who are maybe middle-aged. I don't know what middle-aged means, but maybe getting above 50 and 60, who may present with a picture suggestive of COPD in this type of age group. Now, some of those patients may have smoked for a short time, but many of them haven't. But they're presenting like COPD, and one is inclined to want to treat them like every COPD patient. Now, the use of dual therapy raises the question of a black box warning in these people who are not technically COPD. Is that an issue, or is the black box warning a little bit overdone?
Well, a couple of comments. Firstly, there are different ways to get a diagnosis of COPD, and one of them is to have a more rapid decline of lung function over lifetime. Another is to start off with low lung function, low maximally attained lung function around the age of 25, and some of the patients that you're describing may fall into that second category. As far as the black box warning is concerned, of course, it's applicable to patients with asthma, and it was related to salmeterol originally, but because the FDA considers the risk of death a class effect, all LABA-containing therapies have that black box warning, and thank you for pointing that out. I happen to think it's a misinterpretation of reality. That's my personal opinion. I think if you look back at the SMART study in which the imbalance of mortality arose, and it wasn't even statistically significant, it's probably lack of ICS therapy in patients needing it that was the risk, as opposed to the LABA increasing the risk of death. But, that's all going to play itself out. The Summit study has reported, several companies, as you probably know, were mandated by the FDA to do large safety studies of LABA and therapy. The GSK study has actually reported out showing no difference in mortality between LABA and LABA ICS, and other studies are in the pipeline, which, if they show similar findings, will lead the FDA to review and possibly revise that black box warning.
So I really like your paradigm that you outlined for treatment in non-smokers and ex-smokers. But looking at your data, it seemed about 50% of the patients in the study, one of the studies, were smokers. So I'm proposing that the best inhaler might in fact enable people to continue smoking. So we might see 5 to 10 years down the road that the worst group would be those who found medication that worked and continued smoking and died or had severe disability.
Yeah, I accept those good comments. And of course, smoking cessation is the primary intervention. And we should never lose sight of that, regardless of the other decisions we make about therapy. Rich, good morning.
Morning, Chris. Just a quick question. You know, I read the new GOLD guidelines, and you know, you have to spend time absorbing them. But I'm wondering, as card-carrying physiologists, you know, we've been dancing on the head of the pin on how to define FEV1 lower limits of normal and stuff like that, and arguing back and forth. And yet now we have guidelines that say, don't do that. Look at symptom scores. And essentially, it boils down to saying whether you think you can keep up with your friends when you're walking with them, which is incredibly qualitative. And, you know, given the fact that we talk about COPD patients being, you know, denying symptoms, this is a virtually crazy way to try to decide how to treat people, don't you think?
Yeah. I've lost sleep over realizing that FEV1 or FEV1 FVC ratio just isn't the way to diagnose COPD anymore, because we're missing early disease. And you know, like you as a physiologist, I'm loath to discard physiological measurements. But we just need to get more sophisticated. We need to explore measures of airway resistance in people who are starting to develop CT evidence of airway wall thickening or some other physiological measures. I think as far as symptoms are concerned, we need to elicit them with a standardized stimulus. So we have a provoked dyspnea test, or, you know, we've got to sort of step up to the challenge, I think, of, as we have for many years, of having people disregarding the importance of physiology. It's even more important now, I think, that we rise to this occasion.
Thank you. So we'll break for probably 10 minutes and we'll reconvene. Thank you very much.
out of your way?
Sure.
Good morning. I think that I'd like to call a meeting back to order. If those of you who are standing, if you can find your seats, we'll get the second session going. But, you know, I think this has been a very informative morning, and we look forward to more, and I think that we have more to provide all of you in attendance. I'm pleased now to introduce Dr. Janos Porszasz. I always get the last name wrong, but I think that we all know who I'm talking about. But Dr. Porszasz is the Associate Chief of Research at the, he's an adjunct professor at the Geffen School of Medicine. He has medical degrees from Hungary. He's LA Biomed. And he's been a mentor to a huge number of PhD candidates, visiting sciences fellows. And he has been the head of the Department of Physiology and Ergonomics in the National Institute of Public Occupational Health in Hungary. He's been a has an extensive number of publications and is part of our COPD advisory board for Breathe LA. Is well published expert on oxygen and ancillary services, which is what we've asked him to speak on this morning. Dr. Porszasz.
Thank you very much. Good morning. I hope that I will survive this morning without major disasters. One of them is that last week I was knocked out completely from the cold. I was unable to get up and so on and so forth. So please excuse me, not because of only my accent, but it is a shame to talk after somebody who is speaking such a nice accent like Dr. Cooper. So let me try. How do I? Okay. So my objectives is to demonstrate that activity-related desaturation can be effectively ameliorated by adequate oxygen therapy. A couple of minutes ago, I told Chris that this is going to be my usual style. I will try to highlight and point out shortcomings of the things that we are doing. And one of them is that oxygen conservers may not prevent activity-related desaturation. On the contrary, what we think, that's what we are giving our patients, oxygen conservers, these psh-psh devices, and they may not be as efficient as we think they are. And the effectiveness of long-term oxygen therapy depends on absolutely on adequate oxygen delivery and also compliance. And finally, I'm going to show you some results of our own on an oxygen delivery device which has been categorized as ancillary oxygen device. So the bottom line is that we all know that during walking, patients with COPD do desaturate. And some of us may know that they do desaturate much more during walking than during cycling. And this is associated, according to this paper that was published by Dr. Chaux in 2009, that shows that on the cycling, the lactate threshold is lower than on the treadmill. Therefore, the ventilatory compensation the ventilatory stimulus is much higher. Therefore, during cycling, they reach much higher and tidal O2, alveolar oxygen partial pressure, that seems to prevent desaturation, and that is enough. This 5 to 6 or even 7-8 millimeters of mercury is the difference in the end-tidal O2 alveolar partial pressure is sufficient enough to prevent desaturation. If you think about the hemoglobin oxygen dissociation curve around that region, there is the shoulder of it. So significantly deeper desaturation occurs during walking than with cycle exercise at equivalent metabolic rates. This is very important because our patients are active while they are walking, if they are active or if they are walking. So they may desaturate more. Now, why is this important? This is important because we are trying to provide them oxygen sufficiently through oxygen conservers. Some years ago, maybe 10 years ago, we did conduct a comparison study on two oxygen conservers. I'm not going to tell you which ones. The type A is essentially suffices in the design that it conserves oxygen. That was the design. Because the engineers were told that, okay, I need to deliver up to maybe 1.5 or 1 liter of oxygen. But if the subject is or the patient is breathing more frequently, then they fixed the oxygen delivery. Therefore, the pulse of the oxygen got decreased. And so they were getting less and less oxygen per breath. Now, is this good enough or not? That's a different question. Here is another type, which was also an oxygen conserver, but was actually designed such that it did not decrease the pulse, the oxygen pulse volume per breath, depending on the respiratory rate. Now, we put these two devices into test. And on the left-hand side, you see the type A, the first one that was decreasing the oxygen, the pulse of the oxygen. And on two different settings, type A, setting one, that means whatever it means, and setting three, the oxygenation is essentially somewhat improving, while the oxygen delivery does not even exceed 800 milliliters. On the other hand, here, and the saturation is barely maintained or even not even maintained, here on the other type, does not conserve that much of an oxygen, but achieves a much better saturation at setting three. So I think that the oxygen conservers, the ambulatory and the portable devices, should not be designed such that they conserve oxygen. Who cares about it? What we care about is the oxygenation of the patient. So here is the summary. This was done on 10 subjects at 75% peak work rate, and you see that only the type B conserver was sufficiently maintaining the oxygenation during this type of exercise. Now here is even more. This is the ambulatory oxygen trial that was done in 2005. The results have not been published. These results have not been published. And what you see here is that the oxygen breath per minute, that is the breathing frequency essentially, what we have done is that we followed patients on oxygen therapy while they were using oxygen concentrator from 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. And during this period of time, around 5 p.m. to 8 p.m. or 7 p.m., they went out and used the oxygen conserver, the ambulatory oxygen source. What you see is that the saturation here, while on stationary oxygen concentrator, was maintained around 95, And during the oxygen conservatory ambulatory period, it was insufficient because it was going below 90, and the average was really low. You see that the activity, simultaneous recorded activity, and the heart rate was showing activity-related desaturation bursts. Now, if you use the oxygen conserver, the ambulatory, exclusively, then you see on this patient that the saturation was barely maintained below or even achieved when the respiratory rate was relatively high. That was the only period without activity when the saturation was okay. So the saturation, activity-related desaturation bursts are very important. And during this period, it looks like that the conserver is failing. And that is in average on 10 subjects, the low activity, which is vectorial magnitude unit, VMU unit less than 25, between 25 and 250, and greater than 250, it is clear that the ambulatory conserver is not maintaining the saturation properly. The desaturation events are much higher, number of them per hour is much higher, and the length of each of them is much higher. This is 6 times 4, that's almost half an hour desaturation, below 90%. If you look at all of these participants, we had followed 18 participants, and they were both using stationary and ambulatory oxygen. And you see that very few of them is using the ambulatory oxygen source continuously or significant amount of time, probably because they don't feel good. We don't know that information. This part of the trial has been published by Dr. Casaburi in Journal of COPD in 2012, and that shows that this is a relatively good compliance in terms of relying on the oxygen therapy. The stationary use and the ambulatory oxygen use essentially adds up to 45 to 50 minutes per hour over the full year. It seems like that the lightweight group is more compliant, using around 18 hours a day oxygen, whereas the E-cylinder group is using so significantly less, around 15 hours per day oxygen therapy. Why is this important? This is important because ever since the 1970s, when there were two larger oxygen therapy trials based on which results the current oxygen therapy practice was introduced, namely that if you have this resting desaturation, then the oxygen therapy is introduced. But there is this gray area between 89 to 93, which is a moderate desaturation, and that is exactly what the LOT trial, the long-term oxygen treatment trial, addressed. And this just came out in October, a month ago. So this trial randomized 738 patients to no supplemental oxygen and supplemental oxygen. The main question, the original main question, was actually a very cruel one. Who dies first? That was the question. And because of the slow recruitment and because of this and that, they modified the outcome and mixed it with the first hospitalization, all-cause hospitalization or death. So in any case, 368 randomized to supplemental oxygen and 370 randomized to no supplemental oxygen. This is the no supplemental oxygen group, and that's the supplemental oxygen group. I just would like to show that how well balanced they are. The less than 86, the nadir on the 6-minute walk test by breathing ambient air, less than 86% is very well balanced in the two groups, and all all groups, 86 to 88 saturation and greater than 88, all of them are well balanced. So the results are pretty reliable in this sense, in statistical sense. Now, if you start to look at it, this survival curve, it looks like that the no supplemental oxygen is leading in the combined death or first hospitalization, leading the other group. Up to this point, when it is 42 months follow-up, 42 months is more than three years. It is four years, it's around 48 months, is 4 years. And the starting age was 69. So by 5 years, 4 to 5 years later, the death rate is increasing in the general population anyhow. I do not know if this is reflecting that these are delayed by this event, and they catch up, they have to catch up. So I'm not sure if this is a correct way of doing it. The long-term supplemental oxygen prescription in this trial, nevertheless, showed no difference in time to first hospitalization or death or any other outcomes. And this is a very, very strong message. However, the question still remains. The question still remains, how well these patients were following the prescribed or the therapy that they were asked to follow. How can you expect the blood pressure to decrease if your subject is not, or patient is not taking the medication? So you need to know, and that is what this trial was trying to do, to self-report hours, and there is a meter hours from the oxygen concentrator. The agreement between the two is not all that great. The agreement is the limits of agreement. The lower limits and the upper limits of agreement cover 6 hours. 6 hours on a mean of around 11 hours. So I am not sure if the self-report is a good measure in this sense. And if you look at the other graphs in the report, supplemental oxygen prescribed 24-hour prescription, this is the target. Very few of them, only 15% of the followed patients followed it perfectly well. All of the rest is much less. The average and the median, both of them are around 15 hours. According to the original oxygen trials in the 1970s, anybody who is using oxygen more than 17 or 18 hours has benefit in terms of survival. Now, supplemental oxygen this prescribes for sleep and exercise prescription, the median and the mean were both around 11 hours, and there were people who were using 24 hours, and there were people who were using it for 1 hour only. So the compliance to the prescribed therapy in this trial seems to be not very strict. Therefore, I would like to emphasize, without adequate knowledge of adherence to any therapy, let alone oxygen therapy, one cannot make conclusions as to the effectiveness or the lack thereof. I would argue that the presented adherence assessment is inadequate for the following reasons. There was no active adherence monitoring. Active adherence monitoring is when you instrumentally, electronically monitor the adherence. And it is possible. We have shown that. So it's inadequate adherence monitoring. In those who were prescribed 24-hour therapy, the insufficient adherence was found, in my opinion. In those who were prescribed with supplemental oxygen therapy only during exercise and sleep, both the median and mean oxygen usage was about 11 hours a day, which is insufficient oxygen use for achieving benefit. So this is what my critique to the LOT trial. I don't know whether they will accept it or anyway, but at least it is a thought-provoking area. So in this The following slides, I would like to show you some very efficient oxygen delivery method. This is the Breathe Technologies developed device, which is essentially a nasal pillow, and the device is electronically delivering adjustable volume of pulses between 50 to 250 milliliter adjustable. It entrains some ambient air, and the delivery pressure can be as high as 14 centimeters of mercury. This is water. 14 centimeters of water, which qualifies it as non-invasive ventilator. Now, this is one of our participants on the bike, fully equipped with all of the electrodes and everything else. The primary outcome, according to the company's question, was, does this device help unloading the respiratory muscles? The secondary outcome was, according to their wish, is the exercise endurance and pulmonary ventilation and some other things. So this is, again, we maintained with the transcutaneous CO2, the scalene EMG activity as inspiratory accessory muscle activity recording, and of course EKG and everything else. So here is the electromyogram of the scalene muscle. The black dots is the unencumbered. So it's without any device, the patient was exercising and stopped exercising around 3.5 or 4 minutes. When the non-invasive ventilator was delivering room air, it was delaying the increase in the inspiratory effort by about 2 minutes, and the total exercise in this particular patient was almost doubled. But if the ventilator delivered oxygen, the inspiratory effort was even more suppressed, and the exercise endurance was tremendously prolonged. And that is the oxygen, nasal oxygen, continuous oxygen flow, and that is the NIOF comparison. So you see that the average EMG at EMG activity, inspiratory effort, when NIOF was delivering oxygen, was the greatest, but it was something there when there was only air delivered. So the inspiratory pressure, additional inspiratory pressure, the positive inspiratory pressure did help somewhat, but it didn't turn out to be very efficient in terms of exercise endurance. And this is an exercise endurance tremendously increased, four times as greater than without the device. Accordingly, the shortness of breath, Borg category ratio scale, was significantly less. And so these are the average results. You see that the endurance, when the NIOF delivered oxygen, was almost 18 minutes versus 6 minutes. Oxygen cannula doubled that. And the NIOF air paradigm was not really doing too much. Watch the saturation. Again, oxygen delivery method. This is a continuous flow oxygen. Achieved only 91% versus the NIOF when the oxygen was effectively pumped into the lung. It was 97, 98 in average. And the shortness of breath feeling was much less. And so, patients who used this, and this is one of our patients. He's not even smoking related, COPD. So he was very eager to get more active. When I'm going to violate HIPAA right now, but I'm telling you that he said, and the first time when he used in the laboratory, I'm not leaving the lab unless you let me take it. And therefore, we believe the demonstrated improvements are greater than have been reported for any other intervention with the exception probably of pulmonary rehabilitation, and provide evidence that the NIOF system is superior to traditional oxygen therapy in improving exercise tolerance, shortness of breath, and oxygen saturation. And with this, thank you very much for your attention.
Question.
Okay, it's a great intervention, but Medicare won't pay for what? For the NIOV? For the ventilator. Medicare will pay for it, but on a limited extent, because this device originally, when they submitted, got categorized as oxygen ancillary device. Ever since that I know, they resubmitted it with an additional device that was actually a compressor, a portable compressor. It became much bigger, much heavier, but that came with the categorization of ventilator. And that's the original unit is detachable. So there is a way around.
Okay. Janos, very nice. Thank you. We know there's a lot of misconceptions about oxygen therapy, particularly with low-flow systems and the inspired oxygen concentrations that they can achieve. And I have been very unimpressed in the hospital at UCLA with the use of high-flow oxygen systems, with very high flows up to 60 liters per minute. They're noisy and not well tolerated by the patients. And on a number of occasions, I simply switched the patients to a reservoir nasal cannula and a moustache nasal cannula. Can you comment on how effective you think those are compared with the pulsing devices?
I do not have personal and direct experience with comparing them. But thinking about and talking, discussing it with others, I have the impression that the reservoir system is probably more efficient in terms of oxygen delivery or maintaining the saturation, simply because of the reason that enriches the upper airways and everything else during the expiration, even during expiration, and you are getting more efficiently the oxygen. However, the non-invasive ventilation is probably an acceptable approach. I'm not a practicing physician, especially not in the ICU or in any way, but I think that the non-invasive ventilation and high pressure non-invasive ventilation, higher than 15 or 16, above even 20, might be even more efficient.
In patients who benefit from supplemental oxygen with ambulation, is there a correlation between that and the need for sleep oxygen? Do you understand what I'm saying?
Okay, try it again, please.
People who benefit from oxygen with exercise,
mm-hmm.
Do those patients frequently need nasal oxygen for sleep? Are those two separate?
Well, I cannot really comment on that because I have no experience on sleep desaturation. Sorry.
Intuitively, I would think so, but I'm not aware of any data to support that.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We're going to move right along. I think we're a little bit behind schedule, but we do have the room for a little longer. So it's a pleasure to introduce Dr. Richard Casaburi as our next speaker. I think Richard is, we've go back many years as well, but I think if you look up rehabilitation, pulmonary rehabilitation, anywhere on Google, you'll see his name. So I think that he's synonymous, at least certainly in Los Angeles. He's the Associate Chief of Research in Respiratory and Critical Care Physiology and Medicine. It's a handful at Harvard UCLA, Professor of Medicine. He's the Grandcell Burns Chair of Rehabilitative Sciences at LA Biomed. He's
both has a PhD and a medical degree, and he's been at Harbor for as long as I can remember, as long as you can. So he's an institution at Harbor, and was once chief of the division, and has since stepped down, but he has really been at the forefront of rehabilitation medicine, established a rehabilitation clinical trial center, and has progressed to a full-fledged center, which has advanced our knowledge and understanding of pulmonary rehab and COPD immensely. So it's a pleasure to introduce Dr. Casaburi. Welcome to the podium.
Where's the thanks for that overlong introduction. Yes, I do. I have a great interest in pulmonary rehabilitation, but I've sort of taken a step back recently and tried to figure out where we are and where we're going. And the title, the title that I chose for this, rather than the one that's in the program, is pulmonary rehabilitation: where we've succeeded and where we've failed. I do have conflicts of interest, but they're really not relevant to this talk. Here's the bottom line. The outline is where we've succeeded in pulmonary rehabilitation is establishing a really pretty rock-solid scientific basis, showing that this therapy really has patient-relevant benefits that are really substantial. I'll show you some about that. Where we've failed is that this great therapy is not available. It's poorly available for patients who would benefit. And I'm going to cover that as well, but then I'm going to end with a little bit of hope and a path forward, how we're going to fix this, and see if you think that you agree. Where have we succeeded? Accumulated evidence: pulmonary rehabilitation improves exercise tolerance. That's important. Most patients complain about the fact that they can't do things is their chief complaint. Improves the symptom of dyspnea, improves health-related quality of life by well-validated measures. And it does this better than any other therapy we've got. All the Anoros and Sporivas and all that stuff don't come close to the benefits, size of the benefits we see in these outcomes. So it's certainly an important therapy. It also decreases, when you look at it carefully enough, it decreases exacerbations and other measures of healthcare utilization, reduces depression and anxiety, better than anything else we've got, works better than pills, improves cognitive function and self-efficacy, improves adherence to pharmacological therapy. I actually couldn't find a paper that says that, but I believe it. You know, it's an expert opinion. It must. People understand their disease better. They take their medications better. We've tried to figure out the subset of COPD patients that benefit from pulmonary rehabilitation more than others, and we failed in that because every time we look at a study that rehabilitated a bunch of people and try to compare the benefits, we find that all patients seem to benefit, irrespective of disease severity, gender, age, body weight, socioeconomic status, presence of comorbidities. Everybody seems to benefit from, so all people really need pulmonary, COPD patients really need rehabilitation. How do I know this? Well, a bunch of high-profile publications have documented its efficacy, and I'll cite a few that have my name in them, of course. Here's a nice state-of-the-art review in the Blue Journal, 2005, pulmonary rehabilitation in COPD, a CHEST evidence-based clinical practice guideline. I mean, the highest formative evidence for ACCP, AACVPR, the rehabilitation group, 2007. Here's a New England Journal. Well, the New England Journal must be right. Statement on how you use it for management of pulmonary disease. I wrote this with Dick Zawalik. And finally, ATS, European Respiratory Society statement on key concepts and advances in pulmonary rehabilitation. Big long document sort of detailing how it works, how to do it, and what the benefits are. What is pulmonary rehabilitation? I think that you probably know it's multimodal therapy. Patients come in, they spend 6, 8, 10, 12 weeks in a program, come in twice or three times a week for a morning at a time, and they get a whole bunch of stuff that's delivered to them. Multimodal therapy delivered by a multidisciplinary group for which the physician is not necessarily the prime actor in it. The therapists really do most of the work. exercise training is the key, probably the key part of it, getting people who are usually very sedentary and very inactive to be active is really the core of the rehabilitation program. We've sort of talked about why exercise training works in terms of improving activity and exercise tolerance in COPD patients. We focused in previous years on improving skeletal muscle function. We found that the muscles of ambulation don't work well in people who don't do anything, and besides probably have some sort of either a smoking or a COPD-related myopathy. And rehabilitation can fix that. And that's been documented in a number of publications, including this one that we put together in the previous century, and then an update that was published much more recently. Update on skeletal muscle dysfunction in COPD, pointing out that muscle structure and function is abnormal, why it's abnormal, and then what to do about it in terms of what therapies work. And when we look at the five most effective interventions to improve COPD limb dysfunction in these patients, an important part of their comorbidity of COPD, certainly exercise training is the most effective. And then after that, well, two, three, four. It's all exercise training. Exercise training is really the one that works best.